Anyways, today I'm here to talk with you about the new environmental archaeologies and gender. And you set me the task to think about, are we asking the right questions with regards, and I inserted gender and the environment? Are we addressing the right materials? Are we talking in the right terms to the right audiences? And then the question is, what could such a new environmental archaeology manifesto contain? And I'm going to dip into this a little bit as we can go along, but sum up the lecture in some thoughts around these questions that you put out. As Tora was saying, I'm thinking quite a bit about deep time and queer temporalities. I have the Checking In with Deep Time project and another project that appeared called Curating Time with the Seed Box. But I'm not going to talk about this exactly precisely right now, because I thought now, as we're talking gender, I want to take us from a new understanding of bodies in archaeology and do the parable out into and with the environment. So I was pondering quite a bit if I should actually talk you through my water projects instead, because I've been interested, of course, in soil and water and various kind of elements. So I decided that today will be about gender and material feminism, where I will give those of you, most of you probably knew all of this, but I will give you a crash course in material feminism. And this lecture has, I think we can say, maybe five chapters that we will run through. The first chapter is about gender and material feminism. The second one deals with critical post-humanism and laborative archaeology, that is kind of scientific archaeology, what kind of samples we take from bodies and how we can think about that without ending up in traps where we possibly don't want to be. I'm going to take the knowledge from there and implement it on some of the studies in my Waters of the Time project. And then I'm going to speculatively broad out into the big issue around personhood of waters and try to land that in discussions about sustainability and what my contribution could be to such a said manifest. And here I'm crediting Yannick Simmons for this picture of a person whose hair is braided into grass, or the grass braided into the hair, depending on how you want to see it. So, gender and material feminism then. Gender in itself has been discussed recently. And a world of theory has been used quite frequently in archaeology and heritage studies in the last 5 to 10 years. It's been the questions about becomings and the discussion of personhood, relations, etc., etc. But what I have noted is that the feminist and gender origin of these stories has often been under-articulated. And this has often led to the perception that post-humanism doesn't deal with power differentials. And I kind of felt that I really wanted to kind of lift up that that is not the case at all, because here you have a question of material and semiotics kind of coming together. And for that reason, I wanted to explore a little bit how critical feminist post-humanist theory is quite apt for figuring out new relationships with the archaeological sciences, but also how it could contribute to the new environmental archaeologies. And this in ways that might establish research that works more creatively, affirmatively, critically, and respectfully in the same go. Then, if we're going back to basics, basically, this book, Material Feminism, was published already in 2008. And Stacey Alimo and Susan Heckman here took a position where they somewhat critiqued earlier feminist theory that focused mainly on the discourses about the body, but often retreated from the materiality of lived bodies and their material situations. One can see that they landed in social constructivism, and the critique that they have got from Alimo and Heckman is that they possibly ended up in becoming critique only. and thereby kind of lost the steam. Of course, important critical work has taken place, but argues Alaimon Heckman, there's a need to work more affirmatively and participate in the worldings of the world. Material feminism, in their take, foregrounds corporeal practices, biological substances, experience, and thereby challenge representationalism and the discussion of identity categories. And from here stems, of course, the critical feminist post-humanism that carries out and aim to carry out research that takes materiality and the more than human world seriously. And when I started off studying this field, I was trying to figure out what on earth is the material feminist problem with nature. And I think this is an important piece of the jigsaw that one need to kind of take in order to kind of proceed into the other theories. And the problem with nature is partly that earlier gender theories had a fear of touch with what could be seen as essentialism and reductionism that could come in if you started to kind of get closer into questions about nature, human nature, or nature. So therefore, a research gap started to kind of form. The other kind of take on material feminist problems with nature is the kind of post-humanist take, where women, argues Heckman and Alaimo, often has been classed away as non-humans, as nature, outside the culture, primitive, to be civilized among according to male norms. And thereby, nature-culture dualisms works to set aside certain groups. These ideas, the nature-cultural divide, may have continued into ideas of nature and the non-human as resources to be exploited, up for grabs by mankind. Nature, as such, argues the material feminists, post-humanists, ought instead to be acknowledged as an agent in its own term, active as a signifying power, as a source of multiple inter and interactive cultures. However, such nature is not the purity, but interacting with corporeal humans, more than humans, technology, material, and discursivity. When it comes to analysis of bodies then, because we're going to start moving into how to analyze the bodies with a critical feminist post-humanist take, we can't pass by two extremely important thinkers here. For example, Karen Barad, who now famously wrote the following lines: language has been granted too much power, the linguistic turn, semiotic turn, the interpretative turn, the cultural turn. It seems that every turn lately turn everything, even materiality, into a matter of language or some form of cultural representation. So here Barad lands a materialist critique of representationalism. But then we also have Rosie Braidotti, that also frames the post-human and the dilemma in not all of us can say with any degree of certainty that we have always been human or that we are only that. Some of us are not even considered fully human now. And I think this language is full of questions about power differentials and what these narrow categories that we're kind of pushed into do with us and how they subjugate us. Karen Barad then continued to ponder how matter comes to matter, where matter as meaning is not something that humans just project ideas onto. Matter, as Barad calls it, is an interactive becoming. Things don't exist as things kind of out there, but they come together through relations. And things as such, or bodies, don't precede the relations. They appear as phenomena. And these theoretical tools have been of importance to me, both in thinking about bodies and in thinking about and working with nature cultures and inheritances of all different types of kind. Another piece of the jigsaw that is important to identify is how these theoreticians deal with the question of representation. And this has bearing on questions of how we perceive identity, etc. But they're saying that every time you engage with the world, what you receive from it is not a mirror image, but a riff-off. They call this diffraction. So anytime you make a scientific analysis, whatever kind of comes back is not an exact mirror of what you put in. A diffraction is also a method that you can use in your studies by perhaps reading one text through another, or clarify what happens when a scientific apparatus are applied to a material. Another term that I'm going to make use of towards the end of this lecture is autremondialization. I stumbled across this when I read Donna Haraway, When Species Meets, who is very much about human-animal relationships. But I was trying to figure out what Donna Haraway is after. And I can see that her work is trying to figure out something called autremondialization, which she describes as not about anti-globalization, but about nurturing a more peaceful other type of globalization. And I thought it was funny to kind of make a pun of this in one of my papers that is discussing otherworlding. What Haraway lifts forward here is the importance of retying some of the knots of ordinary multispecies living on Earth. And here I take this as a call into working more with imaginative and speculative past, present futures. Anyway, having this as a theoretical pack or toolbox to work with, I want to bring you into my second chapter that is about critical post-human laborative archaeology. Because when I was working abroad first and came back to Sweden, I decided to kind of take a closer look onto the subjects that interested me. Gender is often connected to questions about identity. It's easy to say that gender archaeology and also heritage studies quite often have been occupied with the notion of human identity first and foremost. And a lot of good works has been done in this, looking at male identities, female identities, etc. To the side of the picture here, you see an osteological chart for determining biological sex stroke gender, if you were talking with Judith Butlerian tools, I suppose. But identities often boils down to questions of who is represented in history writing, what is the other side of the story, and to the ongoing questioning of heritage use for constructing national identity. And this is extremely important work that has been taking place. However, identity, just like self, means self-view, and just as meaning is quite problematic to get to through archaeological means, we can't get into people's head and ask them about their own identities. All we actually have are biological gender identifications. And I think there's quite a gap in between what a person perceives to be its own identity compared to identifications, as in osteological ADNAs or hormonal differences, perhaps. Then we have another tool when we're talking about archaeology and various scientific analysis. We can talk about personhood, for example, how the body is extended with gears, such as one of these iron or wooden spits that adds to the appearance of a vulva, think some researchers, or a tradesperson or a textile dealer, and how personhood might be expanded and added to by their various types of material, gears, performances, etc. But Fowler, who has been writing quite a bit about the archaeology and personhood, of course also says that personhood could be embedded in the wider world beyond the human body and distributed among things, plants and places. Coming with this background and reading up on my materialist feminists, I came across Stacey Alimo's further writings. For example, her book Bodily Natures that launches into analysis of the transcorporeal, where Alimo continued to kind of trouble personhood as we knew it. And instead of seeing this as kind of a human-centered add-on that expanded the personhood, she was looking at all the transformative material semiotic networks of becomings, how the human body became something more together with non-human animals and nature. This body view looks at it as a permeable space with exchanges between the inside, outside, study materials, body interlinkages. And then Alimo called this transcorporeality, and it's a useful tool for reimagining the archaeological sciences. If we bear with us the transcorporeal way of looking at bodies, one can say that the human body is ecological and constituted as a network of changing relations with environment, things, concepts, etc., where bodies are both semiotic and material at the same time. And a body can then be said to be a get-together of various sources and forces, when nature is actually in us and we are in nature, but our bodies are temporally, materially, and geographically situated, differentiating as we go along. So when I started my study of the Water of the Times project, I was thinking I will actually bring critical post-human thinking into laborative archaeology and try to look at osteology that I needed to make use of, ADNA and isotopes. But reading them diffractively as if they are giving much more than identity labels. They can actually be used as a critical mapping of the ecologies of a body if you see it as a network. We all know that carbon and nitrogen values tell us that you are what you eat, but they also tell of relationships to the environment and animals. Strontium, oxygen, and sulfur analysis. You are the places you dwelled in and you change with them. In this way, we actually can work with the archaeological sciences to see how the world is stretching into us and we are stretching into the world, where isotopes inform of the environment within the body, so to say landscape within the body and its transcorporeal links. And in doing this and in encountering the laborative archaeologists, we need to bring with us an awareness of how the apparatus, and the apparatus is both of a scientific and the theoretical kind, cut together bits of the world or bits of bodies and diffract and produce the body as a scientifically studied phenomena. And the reply from the laborative analysis as they come back to us are definitely not a representation of identity. And by making this transformation of laborative practices and laborative results, we can actually move from body essentialism and beyond constructivism in scientific analysis of bodies. But I wanted to twist that yet another step. And I was asking in that 2013 paper, I think that was there on an earlier slide. So is it really personhood? Should we not instead be working with something called figurations, where Donna Haraway helps us along a little bit here, where a figure is not identities and it's not personhood, but it's a way to collect people through their invitation to inhabit the corporeal story tool in their lineaments. What does that actually mean? To me, it actually means this thing that our bodies are kind of full of situated interlinkages with the environment in us and around us that doesn't come across as representations, but our body is rather a knotted together place where diverse bodies come into place and co-shape each other. And I brought this along and I was trying then to figure out, so how do we actually still carry out power analysis, given that we can't situate ourselves in discussions about identity and that personhood might be not the tool that we are after. And then I thought that I could actually make use of these figurations and explore them as sites of power. So then, what do we actually get from scientific analysis of bodies? Well, they mightn't be representing identity, but if they're handled as figurations and situated entrances in mappings of multiple and more than human belongings of a subject, it might become workable. And to take this yet another step, one might want to think about feminist figurations as a tool to map various subject positions and see how they are situated in the world. And at the same time, a feminist figuration is one that has a critical edge to it. It challenges phallogocentrism. It investigates possibilities of a subject position as either positive, that it has a lot of potentials, or negative powers as in potestas. And hereby, such figurations could be seen as lenses that highlights power differentials. And I want us to kind of think about this because I'm going to show you some ways of using this in my research on violence, sacrifice, and necropolitics. And that then brings me on to the next chapter, The Water of the Times. This is a project that has had funding from the Swedish Science Council and various other financiers for some time. Returning from Ireland, I was aware of that Sweden didn't have that many bog bodies. They can be found in Ireland, Great Britain, Denmark, Netherlands, Germany. Now also Estonia, PhD student of mine, traced that. But from Sweden, we have a few well-known human individuals, such as Hallonflickan. These bodies are termed with a kind of place name and the gender description. And there are also human animal remains from a number of known depositional places like Skedemosse, Röekillerna, Finnestorp, and Motalaström. And as we will find out, these are actually stories, multi-species histories of sacrifice and violence, of bio and necropolitics, and also ways of establishing links with the environment. The Water of the Times project has identified approximately some 140 places with human and animal remains depositions in Sweden. And here you see a map of that with concentrations kind of in South Sweden, in Scania, stretching across the country and with the concentration near Uppland. And the questions such as where, when, who, how, why, and to what effects actually change together with the critical post-human lens on how bodies come together and dissolve. I'm going to take you very briefly through two of all these case studies, one at Torres and one at Uppåkra, and try to weave in the transcorporeal figurations, process ontology, and the body in becoming, and land this bit and this chapter in discussions on necropolitics. First of all, in this study, one can identify water as an agential force in the forming of depositional locations. Here you see a photo of the river Fyris, but it's clear that water transportations has created gatherings of human remains, skulls, animal remains in particular places. Not all are found in the places where they were deposited. What also adds to water's agentiality is land rise and water withdrawal that unmakes and makes earlier places. Also, the human remains have skeletal signatures of water rolling. The place at Torres, which is approximately just under, it says Uppsala in this picture, is a place with a grounded up landscape, with land rise and water withdrawal, where human-animal relations were forged to their positions in wet grounds. This is a place that we found in the archives of Upplands Museet, an unpublished find, where, as you can see, two big boulders are kind of framing a crossing place across and over a small little drain in a wetland. Here was found cattle that we radiocarbon dated to the early Bronze Age, horse bones, sheep, goat bones. They're all domesticated hoofed animals. And it was also the find of some human remains in this place. The osteological analysis showed that some of these animals had been exposed to perimortem trauma. The horse had scrape marks and water rolling. The sheep goat has sharp force trauma, cut marks for dismembering of the body, gnawing of the bones deposited after this. So they're quite kind of long pre-depositional stories here that makes these animals kind of come into place as they do. They're again hoofed animals and domesticated. The human being found here was located at a fording place. It came about through osteological ADNA and strontium analysis as a middle-aged man with landscape relations. The landscape as reflected in this body points towards this area. But it's also a body that came together with quite a reduced health status, signs of malnutrition, exposed to the violence to the head and legs during life. And also death came in through violence with sharp head and blow to the head and back, something that we could call networked violence. How these bodies kind of work together, a rope for bonding or strangulation. And this person was part of a network of vulnerability with life and death story that was characterized by accidents, violence, and lack of care. The place in the center was the only place in the landscape where human and animal bodies could travel through transcorporeally as they had to coordinate their joint movements in this very landscape. And the knowledge about this body is produced through apparatuses of both scientific and humanistic kind. Another case study comes from Uppåkra, Gullåkra, County Scania in South Sweden. This was a central place from around 100 BC, and it decreased in importance for the coming 1,000 years. It's located on the rich and fertile soils of Scania and framed by two rivers, Höje River to the north and Sege River to the south. And here there are human remains depositions in a 10 kilometer radius around the site itself. I don't want you to look into all the kind of details of this table, but what we can conclude is that there are concentrations in these human remains depositions, very few animal remains depositions from here, with dates mainly in the Late Bronze Age, Early Iron Age, which predate the buildup of Uppåkra as a central place. There are mainly skulls, and there are selected body parts that were deposited in the waters. And then I wanted to kind of see, carrying out the same scientific laborative analysis as we had done for many other bodies kind of in this project, we can see that it's a mainly male adult gendered material. We can look through the osteological apparatus and see that these bodies comes out as lives that were quite vulnerable, that they neither like the tourist body were connected to nurturing work networks. There are signs of malnutrition and disease, and one can say that they were exposed to the slow violence of the poor, as compared to that many bodies were also exposed to trauma and fast violence. These were people that, so to speak, were partly sacrificed already when alive, as they were outside such networks of care. There's also sign of that these bodies were individuals, they were tingified, they had violent ends to life, there were post-mortem manipulation, they were curated, cut to shape and deposited in the wetlands. And my conclusion around this is that they possibly were not only selected for sacrifice, but also made killable, as they became dead already when alive, as expendable, sacrificable masculinities. And here I'm making use of particularly that name as a figuration for these bodies. Again, these bodies were interned in traditional depositional places, such as Vulåkra Borg. And the water of the time has focused on human-animal things in watery places, life that matters and necropolitics, transcorporeal bodies and multi-species vulnerabilities. So what I wanted to point at in this, the second last chapter of my presentation, is the necropolitical ecologies of wetlands, that these natural, so to say, natural places have come together through processes that has involved bog bodies through life histories of precariousness, vulnerability and masculinity. We can also see that this particular bog at Uppåkra is a place where necropolitics were exercised leading up to the period of the establishment of Uppåkra as a political and economic center. And in the case of Torresta, forming up and firming up crossing points in the landscape. But what I also wanted to point out is that the wetlands were changing, of course, over time. Now I want to go to the last bit of this lecture and discuss something that that troubles me and intrigues me for the time being. And that is the question of personhood of water. And I'm only about kind of to ramble into this field with my studies right now. Some of you might know the discussions about personhood of waters from the news. For example, the Ganges and Yamuna rivers were granted the same legal rights as human beings, and the Whanganui River in New Zealand has been given status and standing as and has rights as a human being. And of course, the question here that comes to us is, to what extent are waters actually alive? Are they persons? Yeah, what we can say for sure is the waters, rivers, wetlands, etc., are teeming with life. They have agentic forces, they carry materials, they have situated materializing histories. But actually, I want to ask as researchers, what happens when they're captured as persons? How can they work as figurations? Are the power differentials that they engender, and are there kind of critical potentials in them? And I've started to wonder what would happen if we were querying waters in Northwest Europe to work with water mondialization. And here I'm starting to explore artistic research and sustainability. But first, before we go into that artistic research, I want to acquaint you with some water ontologies, some of them that come from the Dinchenikos, the lore of notable places, which are medieval documents and letters that, for example, relate to the River Shannon and the River Boyne, but also to Rolf Kraki's saga that bogs were places of transformation that endowed wisdom onto those creatures that came across them. These are kind of two or three stories that I have kind of condensed together with these medieval poems, for example, about the River Boyne in Ireland, where I, of course, have worked for quite some time, got its name through how the river bursted and damaged the eye and hand and the foot of the king's wife, Boond, and chased her all the way to the sea, where she died. and one part of the river was called the arm of Noda's wife and her leg. Likewise, the big river Shannon got a name in a similar process. One can read this description as one of a sacrifice, but also what happened to a body that is left in water for some time. And what one can take out of this is that the text describes how the person Bowen and the river got intermixed in this poem. Likewise, Irish very early sources, like Chiricon's Life of Patrick from 680 AD, talks about a well, Slan, that was worshipped not as a transcendent entity in the world beyond, but as a living deity that was given gifts of both bones, human bones, but also gold and silver. And what I wanted to say with this is that both early literary sources and artifacts can give indications of a rather different way of sensing water, so might give entrances to other ontologies with water, where water was an ally that was not only spoken for by humans, but actually influenced their storytelling and spoke through them. This material gives access to ecological ontologies where waters were observed as alive instead of inert and dead. And that started me off on thinking, what if these depositions and body parts that we find in watery places were not given to transcendent deities, but actually gifts to immanent living water entities? And if this might have been that the river were approached as not only something, but also someone. If that was the case, one could also see depositions of human remains or animal remains or artifacts as ways to expand the personhoods of such water. In the ways that people and river, for example, got entangled and merged into something new. This could be a way also to see how lenses and apparatuses of the time, if we see the artifacts as such, capture certain aspects of the waters. If we take this story a little bit further on in time, we might want to look at, for example, the river Fyris, where I have several human remains depositions from, as having an expanded and changing personhood over time. For example, there has been religious badges and swords found in the river, and the river today is mostly known for all the bikes and all the garbage put into it. And in such case, the personhood of Fyris River would be a very garbagey one. Then I started to query the personhood in itself. Perhaps it's a rather impoverished label to cover a lot of excesses of such waters. That kind of looks away from nature, culture, power differentials, gender, techno stories, and more. As the kind of materializing whirling of rivers like the Fyris is definitely not pure. It's a rather volatile trickster river, full of pollutants. It's overnourished, full of bikes, trash, and various quite unfortunate futures rushing towards us. And what a critical feminist figuration could do in Story Waters, I have started to kind of wonder about. How could they give us imagined possibilities and at the same time reveal the fierce and ordinary reality, to speak with Haraway's words? How could such explorations acknowledge sacrifices made, entanglements, and challenge various meta-narratives? Here I've started to work with Signe Johannesson, an artist, on works such as Death as Portals to Worlds Within Worlds, how to handle the violent histories of use and abuse of animals, for example, where we're touching upon issues on sacrifice, mourning, and recreation. Signe has just opened an exhibition in an accelerator that is the Art Hall of Stockholm University. where this work, the posthumous dialogue, refers to a find that was made in near mid-Sweden, Örebro, where her work starts to bear witness to necropolitical acts, to sacrifice, mourning, and decay. But we're also starting to get closer to issues about how to world the world differently, autremondialization, and figure out imaginative and speculative past, present, futures. I want to start to wrap up this lecture by referring back to Alaimo's paper, Sustainable This, Sustainable That, where I think that any type of sustainable futures need to start to critique Eurocentric masculine universalism in knowledge production. We might need to start to produce situated counter knowledge and figure out past indigenous material philosophy, making use of archaeology in respectful ways. We need also to, as Alaimo points out, look at the cruelty of the sovereign and not shy away from power differentials and namings of exclusions. This is, of course, a very risky business. And here I'm bringing in some help from Donna Haraway, where the outcomes of this exploration is not guaranteed. We cannot assure any happy or unhappy ending, sociologically, ecologically, or scientifically. There is only the chance of getting on together with some grace. And then, to finish off my lecture, what could be my contribution towards the manifesto? Yeah, such a manifesto need to reflect on that, as Margaret Atwood says, it's not climate change, it's everything change. I think we need to bring with us a challenge to high humanistic notions of the humanities, as Braidotti points out, the game-changing notion that a proper study of humanities is no longer man. I think we also need to alter academia and question organizations and old boys networks that still are about, I know, change the tone of discussion, practice care, build unholy alliances, like the Post-Humanities Hub, checking in, the Humus Economicus, to bring with us critical friends. And then in words like to go from critique to affirmation, from meaning to relation, from identity to figuration, and to find a revived relationship with the archaeological sciences. Possibly to engage with climate justice, prehistoric ontologies, and to explore imaginatively alter worldlings, question anthropocentrism, while still tracking the anthropogenic. And with those words, I finish my lecture.